Next is Karim Lakhani, who's from Harvard and formerly from MIT. So,
I was in the old Sloan Building, so it was never this nice.
My doctoral office was in the vault there somewhere.
Yeah. Trying to keep up with the neighbors.
Yeah.
You've got a lapel mic.
So. Okay. Computer just went blank, so. I'll just do an interpretive dance. First, I just want to thank the organizers for putting. Yeah, I'll do that. For putting this together. It's rare that you sort of feel at home with people from multiple disciplines that are here. And as I sort of mentioned in one of the comments in the earlier sessions, I study. Part of my research looks at doctors and collaborations in the sciences. And typically, the time from bench discovery to clinic is about 30 years. That's what it takes. I think we really have the opportunity to, A, bring the computer science world together with economics here, but also that our students that are graduating from our schools are facing these problems today. Right? Policymakers are facing these problems today. So there's a real opportunity to have a huge impact with the work and have it immediately be done. And I think that's the fun part of being an academic and being able to do this stuff. So hopefully this will, there we go, great. So I'm gonna go into the guts of an experiment we ran on looking at self-organization for problem solving. And this is work with some postdocs of mine, Andrea Blasco and Michael Minetti, and Kevin Boudreau, also a Sloan grad at Edlin Business School right now. So just to give you a context, I've been looking at, for about a decade now, how crowds can be organized to solve innovative problems. One area that I've looked at is a lot has been contests and crowdsourcing contests that exist where lots of people participate in trying to solve a scientific problem or a software problem, and then a bunch of papers trying to understand how those institutions work. Some of them are field experiments as well. I look at collaborations as well. So open source as a canonical example of open source communities coming together and trying to solve problems as well. In all of these settings, what's interesting is that people self-select. People self-select the problem, self-select their effort levels, and self-select, if possible, the teammates. I've been very fortunate to be able to work with a platform called Top Coder, which is kind of like Kaggle, but predates them in many ways. They have about 600,000 members who run and participate in contests. And what's nice about this platform is that they have really good skill level data that I use to sort of explain away a lot of the results. And they allow us to mess around with the platform. And of course, when you mess around with a live platform, you get a lot of hate mail. So people send me hate mail saying, you guy at Harvard, you don't know what you're doing. What kind of experiment is this? That kind of stuff. NASA has funded a lot of our work here. Because what we do is we take real problems from NASA, computational problems from NASA, and get them solved through crowdsourcing contests. And then also been very lucky to work with the medical school where they finally agreed to run RCTs on policy questions around collaboration. Like how do you allow scientists to collaborate? What are the different mechanisms for that as well? So it's been fun to sort of be in this world and put this together. This paper is trying to sort of get at how are problem solving teams formed. Now, how many of you have worked in teams before? When you're writing papers, right? All of you, right? Now, just think back. How many in how many cases did you have a manager tell you who you should work for? So we're like one David only. He's working at Google. Your boss isn't here. Hal didn't show up. So it's what's interesting is that's actually a pretty rare group, right? So most organizations, in most formal organizations, it's top down. Your manager tells you who you get to work with and what problem you're going to work on, all right? And that is certainly the world of organizations that we actually try to study, but that's a very different mechanism versus what we see in academia, right? We self-select. We have social networks and mechanisms of reputation that allow us to find somebody else to work with. Similarly, in open source communities, the same thing happens, right? You roam around GitHub now, it used to be SourceForge, or on some obscure mailing list to find a project to work on and participate and collaborate. And then also in crowdsourcing contests too, you see the same thing, that you have strangers coming together, sharing some bits of knowledge, and then going away. Very short-lived collaborations. And a really good example is what happened with the Netflix Prize, which in many ways was like the machine learning comes alive in the general public. The New York Times is writing about it. At the same time, the winners came from this sort of uncoordinated merger of ideas, and certainly Netflix wasn't guiding this process at all. So I'll give you a quick research summary, and then I'll probably run out of time, and so then we'll just stop. But the hypotheses that we are pursuing in this question is that self-organization is actually a costly exercise, right? It's costly, but there may be offsetting benefits in terms of both behavior and information. What we do is we run an experiment on TopCoder, where we have 462 programmers form teams of two, we have a treatment of decentralized self-organization and a control group of a centralized matching, and I'll walk you through the details there. They form teams to solve a real problem. This is from the US Patent Office in image recognition and text. And we have got fine-grained observables and objective performance measures. What we find is that there's frictions in the self-org treatment. Only 63% of the teams form with a lot of costs, good quality, but there's offsetting productivity benefits that we observe, and we see good evidence for the behavioral effects. Okay, so there's two ways to sort of think about self-organization in crowds. Economists sort of say decentralized matching self-organization is hard, there's transactions cost, there's information asymmetries, and congestion problems, right? So if you sort of think about the kidney exchange work that's been done by Al Roth and so forth, right, that was all about saying, trying to find a donor to exchange kidneys is gonna be really tough. We've gotta centralize this together. And so that is helpful. But certainly, social psychologists way, might say that self-determination matters. You having autonomy as a creative worker who can find somebody else to work with may be actually motivating. And so we have these two competing views about how we should perhaps organize ourselves in the economy. And what we sort of think about in this paper is that there's possible benefits here, right? There's probably an information effect, right? We have some of observables that a manager might use to determine what a good match might be, right? But in your search for a partner, the frictions may actually also generate information, which may lead to a better match as well. Similarly, as I discussed before, there may be a behavioral effect of going out there and trying to find somebody and making that match happen. And that these kinds of things may, in fact, drive you to work harder in a setting. So what did we do? So our experiment was we went to TopCoder. We hijacked the platform for about a month, a small part of the platform. And we did a call saying, we have this problem from the US Patent Office. We didn't explain what the problem was. What we said is, you will need to know text recognition, image recognition, and text processing skills. Recruited a bunch of people. And then what we did is we put them into randomized groups of 40. And we said, here's some observables on these folks, skill rating, their background, their countries, their preferred programming language, a whole bunch of things. And said, now rank order amongst these 40 people who you want to partner with. All right, so we asked that of everybody. For one half of the group, we basically did a Gale-Shapley-Tang algorithm to give them the best match. All right, and said, here's your partner, here you go. For the other part, right, we said, you have a week to find your partner. We know we have your preferences, but now go and date online, exchange, and find out if you can have a partner come through. And then after that, we had a 4-week-long contest where they had to code, and we had prizes of up to $50,000 for them to participate. So real money, real things going on here. So what we're getting ahead of time is we can now start to think about ways of what the most equilibrium match outcomes might be versus what the actual things are going to be. And I'm going to walk you through all those details. The problem itself, serious real problem for the US Patent Office. So, the Patent Office gets 600,000 applications per year. They're all flat files, all right? So, you have to include images in the patent application. And the poor examiners, they say figure five in the text, then they got to scroll up. Oh, figure five, okay, that's what they're referring to. It's not hyperlinked or anything like that. And it's not a clean graphic, right? So look at this nice fancy figure six that the lawyers put in, the nice cursive writing for 23, I mean, it's kind of crazy when you look at patent drawings, how elaborate they are, because they're pieces of art for lawyers, but they're all the text is sort of sitting with the graphics. It's not a clean thing at all. So the task was that you're going to get a bunch of patent documents that you need to then look at and then create bounding boxes around these things and labels and match the labels to these bounding boxes, right? And like what we were talking before, it was basically we had a test suite as well as a scoring set that was kept aside. So once there were their algorithms, we could test them against that. And we had also an objective scoring algorithm here to see how good they were doing. So now, you shouldn't believe any of this from now on, right? These are preliminary results. We're just in the middle of figuring this is all out. So I'm going to show you some results, but don't write the results down, please. All right. So what do we see? The first thing we see, as you would expect, right? Fewer teams form under self-organization, right? About 63% of the teams form, 37 do not. Versus, by definition, all the teams are formed in the centralized process. What we see also is that there are lower ranks. So the preferred ranks are lower in the self-organization treatment as compared to in the centralized matching, right? So you have to go search, and searching is costly, especially when you want to sort of match with somebody else. And so that starts to give you a sense of what's going on in terms of your search for partners. And again, just think back to your own experiences when you had to go find a co-author or a partner to work with, and the process you went through to find them. And we find direct evidence of search costs. People are spending a significant amount of time messaging, going back and forth. About 600 messages get exchanged amongst people to be able to discover what the match might be. Now, so this is what happens, right? So we set this up, and then over time, they're going out there and submitting code. Right? And these are code submissions over the 4 weeks, because what people do is that the scoring system is up and running. They can submit a test code right away and see what their score is. And based on the score, they can decide to resubmit again or not as well. And already you can see is that the decentralized dots look, there's more decentralized dots than there are centralized dots. And that's going to be important for us going forward. So first thing we see is that there's more active teams in self-organization, right? So of the 115 teams that were assigned, only 30 were actually active, right? So they're set up, then we flash the problem statement, and a bunch of people drop out, right? Because they go, I don't know what to do, and this is not a trivial problem, right? This is going to require effort. Even though there's a big prize at the end, there's still a non-trivial problem. So 26% of these teams are actually being formed. Now, what we see in the 72 teams that we got through self-organization, right, 63% formed, and of those, 36% were active, right? And there's various ways for us to sort of now think about 36 teams were active, at least one submission. And there's various ways for us to sort of think about the impact of what this 36 means as compared to 30. But you can see, we see even from the first crude comparison, more teams are active from a smaller baseline in this setting. Then what we see is just more code submission in the self-organized teams, okay? So 347 code submissions altogether in the treatment for the control group, right? And 607 submissions, code submissions from the folks that are coming through in the self-organization side. And again, we can have various ways to think about what these numbers mean for us. What you also see, you can do an ocular regression on these data and look at the fact that basically ocular regression, that you guys don't have that? Okay, this is just a Harvard thing. So basically what you see is that, you know, there, if you think about the performance scores here, you know, there's more teams on the higher end in the self-org treatment as compared to the control group. I will show you a real, you know, regression, and what you see is in fact that, you know, there is higher performance overall in the self-organizing team as compared to the control group. Then what you want to know is, well, how does this all translate? So we're running a regression. There's a couple other regressions we have. I'm just going to show you this one. This is hours worked. This is based on survey data. We're serving these people, asking them, how many hours per week are you working? And what you see is that basically, right, people, allowing for a whole bunch of controls, right? So week the survey was put in, the dummies for the persons who we're looking at, the demographics, their alter demographics, alter skill dummies, right? That the self-organizing teams are working about 4 hours more per week. And so over the 4 weeks, about 16 more hours in the contest. And our other analysis that I don't show you here, that the you know, effort matters in terms of performance coming through. And so stay tuned for information effects. We're seeing some things, but we want to be very clear that there's a bit of a selection issue that we have to deal with. So I'm not going to give you those results, but we're not seeing it as much as the big effects on behavior. But we are still seeing that there is some information effects in terms of the productivity of the match being put together. And so summary and conclusions, you know, relatively small search and coordination costs in this online environment, right? I mean, they're sending messages and so forth. And I don't know how to think about the fact that 67% of the teams did form. Like, I don't know what the counterfactual would be to sort of think through properly on this, but, you know, but at least we have this data. We are seeing that there is the cost of trying to find a partner translates into this behavior effect that we see for sure, and also an information effect. That's all I have.
Great. So, we have time. Dave, why don't you get set up?
Sure. And,
time for one. There we are.
When you compare the hours that they worked on it, of those who didn't submit anything, you still included them when?
Yeah, we've done a bunch of things. We've given them zeros. We've taken them out of the set completely. We run selection models, and the results don't change. Yeah.
So you set this up. I'm curious. You're kind of suggesting that the team self, that they're finding themselves as important here, but there's kind of another story, which is it could be that they're better understanding the preferences they have for the other people in the team. So the criticism might not be of the centralized matching. It might be that the matching was using the wrong preferences. And what we really need to do is to get people to better understand the preferences they have for who they want to work with, and we could feed that data into matching algorithms.
Potentially, yeah. So I think that's a great thing. What I would sort of say is, if we have their text messages back to each other, so maybe I could use one of the CS guys to help us figure out from the text messages if what kind of content is being exchanged across these to see, in fact, is it preference things or something else going on? Certainly, as I know, you know, I worked at BCG for a long time,
yes.
You know, and the centralized guys didn't give a crap about my preferences. They just sort of said, good luck. See you later. So I think you asked a really good question.
Yes. Okay, maybe one more, and then I think David will be set up.
Okay.
Related to that, when you have people drop out from the centralized, did they have the kind of demographic and skill-based indicators about the person they were matched with? And like, was that part of their...
Most of our dropouts were people that were lower-skilled people. So that was the biggest predictor of people dropping out. Okay. Thank you.
Good. Okay. Sorry, are you ready to roll here pretty much?
So if you're going to use ocular regressions, please cite me in our lab.
Good.
I wanted to just draw your attention to the note-taking that's going on the whiteboards, which are graphical sort of facilitation of the conversation that's going on in this room. And I just wanted to give a big high five virtually to Sita, who is doing all of the graphical facilitation. The point of this is that so that we can document it and you can go there during the coffee breaks and not let anyone sort of waffle on what they said during their talk because it's all recorded there. And also just to have conversations, we're going to make high resolution digital images of this available through the website afterwards. And that's really all I have. I'm really looking forward to this next session, so I will hand it over to Sandy.
Okay, so I'm the moderator, Sandy Pentland. I guess many of you picked up my book. We had a bunch out there. Thank you. Read it. Enjoy. But this isn't about me. Currently, it's about John, who's from Microsoft, John Langford. And take it away, John.
Thank you. So I've spent the last several years trying to figure out how to sort of deal with experimentation in sort of a machine learning way. And there's a couple tricks that I wanted to show you from learning theory, which I think are not commonly understood amongst people who do experimentation. And then I will show you code that does digital experimentation.
Excellent.
All right, so I was reading an article on Slashdot recently, Tough Choices Ahead in Ebola Vaccine Trials. And it's a basic issue about what the goal is when you're doing when you're introducing a new treatment, right? So, is the goal to maximize the statistical power for choosing A or B, which that's what in the article GlaxoSmithKline says we should do, or is your goal to minimize the regret, which is the number of extra people who die, right? So one of either giving the vaccine is a good idea or it's not a good idea. One of those is the right answer. You would like to, when you get to the future, be able to look back in the past and say, oh, I didn't kill too many extra people figuring that out, right? this is a very, I mean, this really matters for the Ebola epidemic. And Doctors Without Borders was essentially taking this stance. Now, I don't think they actually understand the math of that stance properly, but nevertheless, they were taking that stance. They're saying, look, let's just start a rolling treatment. We'll start vaccinating people. We know it's not going to kill people mostly, and then we'll just kind of monitor the outcomes of the people who are vaccinated. And as we vaccinate more and more people, we'll start to learn about whether or not the vaccine works. And of course, this is not the way to maximize statistical power for determining whether or not the vaccine is effective, and so it sounded like from the article, GlaxoSmithKline wins, and we kill some extra people. It's true. Okay, so these are not the same. If you optimize for one, you end up paying. So if you have a total of T participants, T people that you would consider eventually vaccinating, then you pay an extra T to the 1/6 factor of regret in terms of the analysis. So at a scale of 1 million people, which is where projections about where the Ebola epidemic has been suggested it might go, that would be, you know, about a factor of 10 more people dying, right? If the vaccine itself is effective.
Can you call that the same?
What's that?
I'm just trying to interpret this. 10 times is the same for you?
No, same not as well.
No. Oh, these are no. Okay, okay. The word no is confusing. No, it says no.
Means to be not.
These are not the same.
These are definitely not the same. Right. So that's kind of scary. And then if you optimize for two, you delay one. Right. So it takes longer to achieve the necessary statistical power to actually be sure that the vaccine is helping. And that's kind of unavoidable. Okay, so in learning theory, there's a lot of analysis of regret. And that is kind of taken as the way to do things. In clinical trials, it's all about number one, and that's some sort of incompatibility between the way the laws work and the way the math works. Right? So I don't know how to get around that, actually. It seems like it's hard. Okay, so the other trick that I want to show you is multi-role testing. And the claim is that if you log the right data, you can do 1 billion experiments for the cost of 21 A-B tests, okay, where there's a natural log relating these numbers. Now, a lot of you think, no way. But actually, I'll show you that. I'll just kind of remind you that this is kind of obviously true. and the key really is writing an exponential tail. Okay, so I'm going to think about a hypothetical situation where we're trying to figure out how to choose which news articles to display to people, right? And we have, in this hypothetical situation, we have people coming to a website, and we randomly choose a news article, and we display it, and then we see if it's read or not, right? And then another person comes, we have another news article, another random dice. It's a news article about food, and then we see that it's red. Another person, another random roll, and so forth, right? So we just keep doing this. And now, suppose that in addition to the basic events, we happen to log a bunch of extra variables about these people, right? So maybe we know their profession, right? So maybe we're interested in a career rule. So one career rule would be that teachers are given articles about food, and engineers are given articles about space, right? So if we happen to log these things, then we could retrospectively evaluate the quality of, we could see which events agree with the career rule, right? Okay, so these two events agree, and then we could look at, conditioned on agreement, you know, what fraction of articles were read. Okay, so now, if we happen to log location, and we were thinking about maybe sending space articles to people in Texas and food articles to people in Seattle, then we could see which events agree, and we could look at how well that performs. Okay, so now there's something a little bit funny here, which tells you we're already outside of A-B test land, because we have an event which agreed with both. And that's kind of good, actually, because it means that we have more events we can evaluate with a little bit more statistical power. But now we can just keep going, right? So if we're looking at a gender-based rule, maybe we send space stories to men and food stories to women, and then we see which events agree, and then we can just keep doing things over and over again. And you can see that if you have a large number of variables or a large number of ways to combine these variables, think about machine learning, you can have an enormous number of rules that you can evaluate. Okay, and then let's go back to what I said earlier. I said a billion A-B tests for the cost of 21. So what's happening is the central limit theorem. Central limit theorem says that the deviations in your estimates of the value of these are like a Gaussian, essentially, right? And that means you're going to run out into the exponential tail, and that means there's this natural log relating the number of experiments that you can do with some particular deviation. And that's why you can do a billion tests on the data for 21 independent A-B tests. All right, so you collect 21 times as much data as before, you can do a billion tests to the same certainty. Okay? So now, Another question which comes up very commonly here is, can't you just do this? Isn't this just an A-B test? I mean, it kind of structured as an A-B test because we were just randomizing between two different articles. And in terms of the user visible effects, it's a lot like that. But typically when you're doing A-B tests, you don't log all of these extra variables. And then it becomes very hard to join with these things properly. And also there can be issues like if you were randomizing between a career rule and a location rule for your A and B, then maybe the gender is related to the career. And then it's kind of hard, I mean, it becomes tricky to kind of control for all of those correlations. So the data that you get from a typical A-B test can be kind of used to do these kinds of things. But it's much better if you're just thinking about this in advance and you want to do this directly. Okay, so this is, do people believe me? Do you believe that you can do a billion tests for the cost of 21? Some people kind of believe. Interesting. People kind of believe, but not very much. What's that? This is
multiple testing
in some sense, yes. Although it's kind of a tricky multiple testing because I'm using the same event many times, right? So it's not like A, B, C, D test where you divide things up into partition into four different streams, right? And that's really key. All right, so how do I convince you? Oh, I'm just showing which events agree with the rule that I'm evaluating. Right, so there's a career rule.
Like the last line. I thought you said male was read, which doesn't match with the labels. I
know. No, male was getting space stories, and female is getting food stories, and male is getting space stories, and this event does not agree. So it's not circled. So I'm just selecting out the set of events which agree with the rule that I want to evaluate.
So you just
independent of the click.
You're randomizing the article, not the rule. That was the key point. And now you're
right. Right. So I'm randomizing the article, not the rule. That's important.
Yep.
And then because I know this randomization, that actually applies to all rules that choose that article.
Yep. All right. That's
right.
Much better.
Okay. Now do you believe?
Possible.
Okay, a few people believe. I think I have to settle for that.
We're all open to it.
Open to the possibility that might be true. That's good. all right, so this means there's a difference in methodology associated with this multi-world testing. So in A-B testing, you kind of it's a very scientific approach. You decide an experiment, you get the data, and then you do the A-B test, right? And Ronnie worked on the Being EXP platform. He had a paper where they were finishing about 30 tests per day. It's probably more than that now. But I mean, that's a major A-B testing platform in the industry, right? okay, so this is A-B testing. With multi-world testing, it's different. What happens is you get the right data first, and then you just experiment offline like crazy, right? I mean, you just run experiments all the time offline by selecting the events which agree with your rule. Okay, so that means you can easily do 1,000 tests per day per person, right? It also means you can plug it into learning algorithms, which I'll get into a little bit later. So this, at this point, well, there's one other trick here, which is that you can actually achieve performance levels you can't get with A-B testing. So A-B testing is very bad at making a large number of small improvements, right? But if you manage to shoehorn a large number of small improvements into by multi-world testing, and then you validated that later with A/B testing, for example, that would fly, right? So now there's a point here where people are like, oh, kind of violating the scientific approach, right? You're not doing A-B testing. You're not proposing first and then and then testing. And there's a basic answer to that, which comes from machine learning. The answer is you have a holdout set. So you take some of your events and you hold them out, right? And now you experiment like crazy on the main set. And then after you find something that you're confident that you like, then you test it one last time with the holdout set. Right now, there's no all the randomness between these two sets is independent, and so it's valid.
Not when you do 1,000 tests against the holdout, right?
Not when you do 1,000 tests against the holdout. That's true. Same problem happens in machine learning. It's exactly analogous. Right. So you need to be careful about how you use the holdout set.
Or you can repeat the experiment after you find your candidate.
Yeah. So a natural usage mode is you gather the data, you do a bunch of experiments, you do whatever you want on your holdout set. Maybe you do it 1,000 times, I don't know. You find something that you like, and then you A-B test it one last time. What's that?
It's not necessary to randomize the articles either.
It's not necessary to randomize the articles.
In your first slide, you had those things up there.
Yeah, it is.
Because the people that come to your website are random. You don't know who they are.
No.
They're biased. I mean,
so, if you could model things and measure a bunch of stuff we don't know how to measure, you might be able to avoid this. But we're trying to control which article is displayed, and that means we need to be randomizing which article is displayed.
Why are you trying to do that? Because you're doing it afterwards.
Let's say that we want to have more clicks on our website. I don't know. Companies do that sometimes.
You just need to make sure it's uncorrelated with user characteristics.
Yes.
That's right. Yeah.
Including things that may be unmeasurable.
Yeah. So randomness is an easy way to do that.
You could alternate even in odd seconds. It would probably be fun.
That would probably work. Okay, so.
So, first you're pitching this as multi-world testing, PS A-B testing, but then you yourself say that this would be great for finding a hypothesis, but then you would still A-B test that hypothesis.
Yeah, I'm contrasting the methodology here and not saying that multi-world testing is better than A-B testing. I'm contrasting the methodology, right? So there's a different methodology to the use here. And you need to understand the difference in the methodology to really understand what this means.
So it sounds like what you're doing is generating hypotheses with this that you then A-B test afterwards?
It could be done that way. Or it could be that you have a holdout set and you...
The holdout set,
and
you
just,
that's where you get your statistical test from.
Yeah.
Because doing it this way, you don't know if the things are... If what you're finding is valid or spurious, right?
In general, true. Yes.
So it's not really an apples to apples comparison.
I'm comparing two different methodologies here. So look at that part right there. So get the right data first, experiment like crazy. That's a different methodology from experiment, decide.
The part you said later.
Yeah.
And then A-B test. Or then look at the whole data.
Yeah, I'm not going to commit to that because there's a caveat. The caveat is that I care about regret instead of statistical certainty. So if I want to minimize regret, I don't necessarily do an A-B test. Yeah?
The way I understood your comment before about an exponential number of tests is that the turnoff, like ballpark number, says that all of these, with high probability, you're correct given the numbers of experiments you've done. Right? And so if they're all with high probability correct, that's high probability now.
Yeah.
So if you just use the answer you have, then in terms of your regret, you've done well without even verifying that.
Yeah. So if I only do a billion tests or only search amongst a billion tests, then the deviations due to the variance are similar to the deviation that I have for an A-B test with 1/20th of the data. That's correct.
Question.
Yeah?
I mean, one thing that's kind of interesting about this is that people already do a lot of this in field experiments in economics and in health and so on. Like, they do an experiment and they look and see if the drug worked for this subgroup or that subgroup.
Yeah.
Now it turns out, I think the health people have said that that's bad and evil and illegal because what they're worried is that you're going to sort of do a drug trial and then you're going to find, you're just going to kind of data mine in the bad sense of the word data mine, not the good sense of the word data mine, and find some little population on which you have, you know, a positive result, and then say that that was what you were looking for all along, which is why this is illegal. Now, you proposed a solution to that. I'm also doing some work related to this, and that aspect of similar solution, you have a holdout sample, and so then you can sort of make sure that that effect also works on your holdout sample to say that actually this is a piece of what you're proposing is in fact so popular that it's unpopular and then prohibited.
Yeah.
But those guys don't usually come up with rules, like show this to those people under these conditions.
Well, the rule would be that the doctors can prescribe the drug to a certain subcategory of people because they're worried that that was just spurious and you're going to kill those people.
Yeah.
And you're using that as an excuse to get your drug approved by the FDA.
So certainly overfitting is a real serious issue, and you need to avoid it in all those same ways that you avoid it in the...
So economists have actually proposed that economists also have to specify ahead of time what they should do before they run their
research. Yeah. Okay, so I think I'm about to get kicked, but... okay, so if you wanted to do these two things together, that's contextual bandits. That's actually, there was a remarkable paper about 19 years ago which proposed the first statistically optimal solution for this. So you wanted to make this computationally tractable, and since you can search over that billion tests in a reasonable amount of time, then there's a new paper this year about this, right? So this year, we figured out how to make this computationally tractable, and I wanted to show you what this looks like, right? So I have a data set here. This is a bunch of features, right? So it's a bunch of events, one per line. It's a bunch of events, one per line. And now I'm going to... I need to make this a little bit. All right. Much happier. Okay. So I'm running through the data set on every, this is the number of experiments that I've done at this point. I know how to keep an unbiased estimate of my performance, which is getting better over time. And then I just finished going through 729,000 experiments, each of which was proposed by a machine learning algorithm, and then its result was fed back into the machine learning algorithm so as to optimize the predictions that it was making, the interventions that it was doing. All right, so this is code for digital experiments. All right.
Okay.
Thank you.
Are we good here?
Almost.
Almost. We got bits on the screen. That's good.
And is the audio working? All right.
Yep. Okay. David Lazar. There we are.
While we're getting that up, I just want to also reiterate my appreciation of the organizers for the event. This has been fabulous. And actually, the time for doing this was just perfect. I mean, you know, even down to, you know, timing off of a disaster, which in some ways the emotion Facebook experiment was for the area, actually timing is perfect. So I shouldn't say the word disaster. Oh, I see it up there. So if everyone can just turn their head around.
I've got it everywhere but there.
Hmm. Is there any way all right, hopefully that won't be too problematic, as odd, hoping it will flash back, in any case.
Yeah,
okay. Run it
at 10:24, 7:68
if you can. Let's see. Sorry, everyone.
Sorry, where's the
hardware?
Hardware, sorry, I should, there we go. Oh, everyone can see me do this, okay. 1024, 768, all right. And is it looking good? Not so much. Yes, all right. All right, well, thanks. This is the wisdom of the crowd, so. No. Okay, great. Excellent. Well, no talk is complete with a little technical glitch. So this is actually going to be a talk more about a platform and an approach to doing experimentation, not a set of experiments. It's not, usually I would be presenting a set of experiments, but here I was reflecting, and Sinan knows I was struggling a little bit with what to present because I actually have some substantive stuff to present, but I decided actually this is the crowd that should really hear about this and think about whether the utility, what the utility of this is. I should also point to my collaborators, and this is actually not even all of them, but this is sort of the core set of folks working on volunteer science. The genesis of this was I obviously have scientific interests, actually, related to a number of folks, Karim's work and Jeff's work and other folks' work, to try to understand how we think together. You know, this is a question I've been wrestling with actually ever since college when I was on the way to being a cognitive science major. I ended up not quite getting there and being an econ major instead. But the thing that always bothered me a bit about cognitive science was that it focused on what was happening in one mind, one brain, when in fact most all creativity in some sense is what happens among brains, among minds. And so so this is something that I sort of stored in my head for a long time and did eventually circle back around to in my career. And doing a set of experiments looking at how people try to solve certain types of problems together. And my instrument for doing that was this laboratory. It's the Harvard Decision Science Laboratory. It's about as nice a behavioral research lab as you would ever see. Very high tech. You can also get biometric stuff in DNA, and they do stuff to stress people out, like have them put their feet into ice water and so on to see how people behave under stress. We ran these a few group experiments, and one of the things that quickly became apparent was what a pain in the ass it was to use this kind of laboratory for doing group experiments because it was incredibly time consuming and expensive. So just as an example, some of the experiments, actually stuff I'm working on is Jesse Shore. Too big a crowd. So Jesse, work I'm doing with Jesse, looking at problem solving is based on data we collected from here. It took us a year to run 16-person group experiments to get barely enough data to do what we wanted to do. It took unbelievable amounts of grad student time, took tens of thousands of dollars of subject costs, and we literally used every single subject in the shared subject pool for all of Harvard, right? And so around this time, I go to Wynn. I think it was Wynn, I'm not 100% sure, and I see Duncan present as the stuff on online experiments, like, oh my God, this really is the answer. I mean, that is how to do this. But the question really was how to do this to manage the overhead. That is, not to build a sort of single-use tool, but to build something that could deal with all the overhead of running group experiments. So run experiments online, but do it in a way that you're reducing the costs of running more experiments and different kinds of experiments in the future. So that's what we turned to thinking about at that time. And again, these are the kinds of problems we have with physical labs. Physical labs have their place in extraordinary scientific possibilities because you have a certain degree of control in physical labs that you really can't in online labs. But there are these huge issues in terms of how do you deal with large N groups, the costs of paying people are very high, and then issues around validity in terms of the very peculiar samples you get in college labs, which even when you broaden the samples to the broader public turns out to be problematic because when we did broaden it, it turned out that the people we were getting in were alcoholics and drug addicts, and that was a very idiosyncratic sample to work with. So obviously there has been, and this is why this moment is ripe for a conference like this, and many of these names are familiar, this trajectory of research using online platforms, and Duncan summarized some of this. But again, the challenge has been, how do we deal with the overhead? And especially I'm thinking of, how do we make something that's a bit more accessible, especially to social scientists who want to do behavioral research? And this is where the platform Behavioral Volunteer Sciences come in, and you can go to Volunteer Science to look at this. This is what I'm going to be talking about in terms of what we have built and what we hope will be a tool for the community. So what were we trying to do? We're trying to build an online laboratory to support large group experiments where people were working together synchronously on a problem. And we were also wanting to build something which would build a panel of people where you might be able to get some baseline data on them, let's say personality data or demographic data, what have you, and then use that background information in subsequent experiments as compared to collecting it repeatedly. Again, we want to build on established, robust technologies that are well understood by the broader community. And we wanted to integrate with existing tools like Amazon Mechanical Turk and Qualtrics. And also, we wanted to build it on Facebook so that you could authenticate through Facebook, although we also have two paths for authentication. But then also potentially extracting, with consent, of course, Facebook data. And Facebook begins as a huge repository of information and allows us to build a bridge also between the sort of more stylized experiments and actually real-world data and behavioral data. That is, we can see how people behave in certain ways in the real world and link that in with the experiments that we're doing in various ways. Also, we wanted to allow for easy replication and robustness. That is, if we have code for an experiment, we can easily give that to someone else. They can run exactly the same experiment. Furthermore, of course, with most lab experiments, it's so expensive to run them that you don't want to run like a million little tweaks to the experiment because that's expensive. But if you can take your basic experiment, but run it with arbitrary differences, changes, and find that you get the same basic results for those different arbitrary tweaks, that should give you much more confidence in the set of results that we see. And so what have we done? So let me actually, hopefully I'm connected to the internet still, and hopefully this won't disappear. Excellent. So I'm going to take a moment just to give you a sense of this. So you can go to Volunteer Science if you want to, but I'll just show you right now that you can go there, you can volunteer. So I'm interested, one of the problems we have people working is having lots of people solve the traveling salesperson problem. We'll skip instructions, but the basic idea is that we're manipulating how people can see each other in solving this the TSP. And I'm just going to go through one round. And I'm not trying to do well, so don't critique my solution. And then we submit. And then we try to get people pointed in the right direction. We can see, we manipulate whether you can see other people, you know, this person, you know, and we substitute bots in when we don't have people. And we can, this person is obviously very odd and so on. And so this right now is just all bots, so just for demonstration. But the idea here is that people can volunteer for a bunch of experiments. Now I'm going to show you the researcher side. This looks a little different from what you'll see because I'm a researcher. And I'm registered as a researcher. But let's say I go here. You can see all the team members and all the experiments we have set up. So here are all the people working on experiments. And let's take, we saw Duncan talk about Wildcat, very briefly talk about Wildcat Wells earlier today. And so we actually, this is a useful template for us for some of our projects. So we've actually redeveloped Wildcat Wells. And what you can do, what you can do is within the code you specify certain variables, how many players, you can upload a network to vary the network of connections among people. So those are all custom variables defined in the code that you load into the infrastructure. And what does that code look like? Well, if you could scroll down, the wildcat.js, so this is all done in JavaScript, is here. We have 15 versions of it, and let's say we want to look at the code. It's a non-trivial amount of code, so it's around 1,000 lines of code to duplicate what Duncan Winter did already. But that's actually not an overwhelming amount to develop, especially if you have all of the overhead for managing this. And so, so in any case, and then there are other files that where you load images and a few other arbitrary things. But you can rapidly deploy many versions of this experiment. So once you're done, you can rapidly deploy another version of the experiment. You can randomly deploy different networks and so on. So we could replicate what Duncan has done, and you can we can see here. Whoops, I had already, we could, I had done this with five players before, and apparently that's not refreshed. We'll stop that for a moment. But we can launch, see if it works this time. Basically, if I wanted to launch a five-player test experiment, this would be in a sandbox. I would just need to give you this link. And five people could be playing this. So let's say if we just want to play it but not have it go public. There's another layer of administration. So like we have to actually be the ones, as a central people running volunteer science have to be the ones to decide to press the button when an experiment goes live. And then there are other elements here in terms of admin and so on. But I just wanted to give you a sense of what this enabled. We have lots of other things going on the website right now. I'm not going to show you this now. That was my backup in case the online version did not work. We have a particular way of managing consent because we want people to start playing games before they're consented. We don't start collecting data. We don't store the data until they consent, so they can play the games and then post hoc consent. And it varies a little bit by type of experiment, but basically, surveys have one type of consent and the behavioral games have another. It is a no deception paradigm because with I think intrinsically with online experiments like this, you can't really have deception because it will contaminate the rest of your experiment. The word will spread. So in any case, the idea here again is that it's meant to be very easy to deploy, very easy to get other research teams on board. We've built pipelines to run with Turkers. We can run what we've been doing. We've been running with volunteers, but then when we need large groups, we still need the volume that Turkers and the burst that Turkers can provide. Because one of the issues that we are wrestling with still is how do we get bursts of volunteers? People can also actually run this in their own local laboratory if you have appropriate bandwidth. So it deals with a lot of the overhead, even if someone wanted to set up a lab in their college basement, it actually helps deal, just set up a bunch of Chromebooks and suddenly you've got a lab where you can run experiments. The data, this doesn't look good, but I should have shown you before where the data pops out in a pretty easy format, records all the time-stamped information. Obviously, as you saw, allows synchronous communication at any sort of arbitrary scale. So what we've been working on right now is to validate the platform is to do replication studies of some canonical studies in various fields, experimental fields. So for example, we have done reaction time experiments, which with low latent measurements works quite well. We've replicated sort of standard findings. We are doing these standard survey-based measures to see, do things scale up with the big five as it does with canonical data collection? And the answer is yes. We haven't done this yet, but there is this long tradition of network experiments going back to the 1950s with Bavelis. And so we've designed, although using a slightly different way of framing the problem, a version of the Bavelis experiments to see if we get a similar set of results as the original Bavelis experiments. So, I think this is working, this is flying, but we actually have a number of challenges, and I just want to put this out to the crowd, because you can come grab me afterwards, because I'd love both to potentially get collaborators in terms of researchers, but also how do we make this thing work for the community? And the biggest number one challenge, of course, is getting, unsurprisingly, is how do we get enough volunteers? So we have been, you know, this is where we were in February, which was not very good, and per month. And now last month we've got 600 something people, subject experiments. So that these are some repeat people playing again and again, mostly unique people, but it's some combination. But this is roughly, I'd say, at the volume of a small research lab at a university. My aspiration would be to get to, let's say, 10,000 subjects a month. And now that would be talking about something significant, right? And that's where I'd hope to get, like I said, at the end of the year. But the interesting question, you can see, it's mainly US, but there's actually some usage around the world. We had this weird spike 2 weeks ago in Uruguay. I'm not sure what was going on there, but we had suddenly 40 people show up in Uruguay. And we've done various things. We've tried advertising. Maybe this is the right crowd to figure out how to do this right, but we sure as heck didn't do it right. We had an impressive melt from 2 million impressions to 2,000 clicks to 24 valid observations. Yes. I was like, geez. Wow. And then we did some print advertising on the Boston's Green Line. We had done another thing where we actually got quite a few people. You know, you get stuck in the Green Line for a while, and what are you going to do, right? And part of it is like trying to find the crevices in people's days where they're just sitting there in the airports or in trains and so on. But we that didn't actually particularly work. We have tried other things in terms of social media, in terms of our personal networks. I think if anyone follows me on Twitter, you've probably seen many, many pleas, and some of you have kindly retweeted that. And that's actually been somewhat effective. Reddit actually has gotten some spikes, Facebook as well. We've also given people, you know, a lot of psych classes require people to, or encourage people to do experiments. And we actually have an automated certificate that can be generated for students so that they can then bring this to their professor. And we've tried to advertise this to professors. Any of you who have large classes, please feel free to make your students do this. But the question, this isn't for right now, but come grab me afterwards or in Q&A, talk about participation. Just the other thing I want to mention is we're looking for collaborators, we're recruiting, and again, we're also, the other final thing I want to say is we're working on a model for sustainability, because obviously the infrastructure does cost money, and so part of the question is how do we make this work in terms of paying the developer and paying other folks, the project manager, and that works okay in the short run since we have grant money, but in the long run we need to figure out some way to cost share in the community. Anyhow, thank you very much.
Thank you. Good.
Do you have a couple questions?
No?
Oh, I think back there.
Back there.
Thank you. That was really interesting. I'm just wondering if you should have other citizen science platforms like Galaxy Zoo or particularly the folks who run Galaxy Zoo use Green. That as a platform to send other scientists doing work. So what about reaching out to other volunteers to see if they might want to join this pool?
I think that's a great idea. I think we've put out some tentative feelers, but not really assertively asking. So that's on the to-do list, because it turned out that building the infrastructure took much more bandwidth at every level than I was hoping. I guess that's to be expected, but that is now on the to-do list. And I think that's a great idea, because that's sort of mining where there's been success before.
One more, yeah. So is the idea that this platform is essentially a code management system, right?
Like it, yes. It,
so any once you sort of have people coming in, and this can be opened up to researchers,
yes,
that could use non-network experiments as well.
Oh yeah, no, actually a lot of the experiments we're running are non-network experiments. I just think that this is where I'm coming from. Actually, to be honest, right now it's better for running experiments on single individuals. If your units are single individuals, where we could be cranking out several experiments a month worth of data, depending on the scale that you need. But it's a real problem when you have 600-700 people a month, which is, you know, 20 people a day or so, doesn't get you the bursts of activity to have groups that often. So it's actually right now better to run non-network experiments. But my aspiration all along has been to run network or group experiments. But yeah, it's really meant as a full behavioral research lab, not just a network experimental platform.
Great. Okay, well, why don't we do the panel here?
Yeah.
So you can
I'll unplug.
Oh.
unplug and
we can leave it.
Yeah.
So I had a question, I think mainly for John, but anybody could answer it. So at the beginning you talked about the trade-off between power and regret and, or having to make a choice, and it seems that the right answer is you want to do both and balance, have a weighted balance of those, and that there's that in, more specifically you want to think about doing additional tests, additional power to the point to which the marginal benefit from the expected marginal benefit from the additional knowledge is equal to the expected marginal cost from the people who may die, and that's the way you'd want to optimize that, and you could estimate how likely it is that this will lead to an additional death, and that would be updated, and you could estimate how much additional, what the value of the additional knowledge is. I mean, it's sort of, there's a literature on sort of optimal amount of experimentation. I think there was a paper by Philippe Aguillon some years ago about monopolist experimenting with unknown demand and testing different prices, and every time the monopolist strayed from what they thought was the optimal price, there was a cost, but also there was some additional learning that happened, and it seems like you'd want to just trade those off.
Yeah, so I think there's a buzzword for what you're talking about, which is value of information.
Yeah.
And the idea is that you estimate the value of information, and then you go and you...
And the cost. Right?
Yeah, so the one thing which is a little bit tricky with value of information is estimating value of information can be a harder problem than choosing the right treatment in general. So I think I usually think about this in sort of machine learning terms. So if you're trying to estimate the value of information, so all that you really need to know in order to do a treatment is that one thing is to choose the right treatment is to know which one is better. And that's an easier thing to determine in most situations than determining sort of how much value there is. And so you need additional modeling capacity or observations or features to help you model the value of information. So I'm not...
Well, it depends on which precision you want. I mean, you could have some Bayesian rough estimate, and then if it's not exactly right, it's still not. It's better than nothing.
Yeah, so... I think in general the idea is roughly in the right direction. The caveat would be there can be times when estimating the value of information is much more complex than choosing the right treatment, right? And so it seems like the kind of thing which can be helpful sometimes, but I personally find regret much more convincing. Let me tell you another reason why I find it more convincing. I find regret more convincing because it composes in a much better way than A/B tests. If you wanted to, run your own A/B test before somebody else runs an A/B test, you have to do experiments and then they have to do experiments. But if you're doing regret, you can actually compose that in a manner which means that you don't have to lose a lot of extra samples. I'm not getting that cross right. Okay, let me say this another way. I ran through 720,000 experiments. If I had to do an A/B test for each of those experiments, it wouldn't have worked, right? I would have run out of samples after like 20 A/B tests. I would have made 20 updates to my model, to my machine learned model, and I would have gotten nowhere useful. So the fact that I was working on a regret basis meant that I could keep updating and refining as I was making observations, and I could update and refine after every individual observation. If you're working in an A/B test-like paradigm, can't do that. You have to check everything that you're doing.
Well, let me ask a question. So combining what you said and what you said, it sounds like one of the lessons here is when you do these things, you should collect as many contextual variables as possible. Because you can't do the sort of things that you're talking about, or even if you don't buy what you're doing, you can't do the machine learning ancillary variables, potential hypotheses sort of stuff without getting a lot of additional context. So what do you think about that? I mean, are you aimed at that or?
Well, I think on volunteer science that it's actually well designed to do exactly that because, number one, because of the panel nature of the data, you can often have lots of other data that you've already collected about people, and indeed you can, once we really get going, you could restrict your sample sometimes if it's really important to getting people who have done a bunch of, let's say, personality and cognitive and so on surveys, but also because of its integration with Facebook, if you have consent, you can actually then extract all the data from Facebook and look for the role that context plays and the kinds of treatment effects that you're looking for. So I think that might fit well. And furthermore, you can do it at a scale, a much larger scale, so that you can get enough data where these machine learning approaches might be powerful.
So let me make a suggestion. This is something that we're doing with Mass General, where we're facing these sorts of problems. And what we're doing is we're giving that sort of software plus mobile phones and other things to a few thousand employees and collecting everything that we possibly can, just indiscriminately. But then what we want to do is when we have a hypothesis, we want to be able to say, well, do we have the data to answer this hypothesis? And go back and turn the switch. And if you look at the IRB process and the patient recruitment process, you've just cut half of the time off of the medical search problem. And so I liked sort of what you were saying because of this collecting a lot of ancillary data, but you were going to say something.
Yeah, so my top candidate for replacing big data as a buzzword is right data. I think collecting the right data is the important thing, right? And in situations like the hospital, I think you just collect everything because actually collecting that from, I mean, the process of, once you, even collecting one thing has a large cost, and then the incremental cost of collecting more data beyond that is very minor. I've seen other situations, though, where people are like, oh, we have this giant logging system, and if we turn everything on, the entire system chokes, and that's not collecting the right data. Right. So you really want to focus on collecting the right data. And what exactly is the right data, I think, depends on your application. But you also want to take into account the cost of collecting the data and thinking about what the right data scope is. And I agree.
Yeah. Just as a sort of random, one of the people I work with is building a scanner now that records the position and configuration of every molecule in a small brain. Think about the data. Anyway, do we have other? Yeah, right. It's like, that's big data. Yes.
So I just want to pick back up on just the volunteer science bit for a second. How many of your experiments are? I mean, I keep thinking the number of hours spent, say, playing Fruit Ninja. I mean, it's non-trivial, right? So or whatever. I mean, that's the only one I know. I don't happen to do this, but. I mean, I have, you know, so it's the only one I've heard that this is a thing, right? Like, but you know, I mean, so, the demonstration you just showed, right? I mean, I'm moving in this direction with my studies, right? I want to turn every study into a game, largely because I think I'll get better data. In your study, if instead of clicking, I have a frog moving just on lily pads, right? I'm still solving the same problem, but now I might solve 20 of them because I want fewer hops, right? Or whatever. Is there, like, I mean, this I feel like this is a testable sort of intuition, right? It's like if you have experiments that are gameable, can volunteers rank them on funness? I mean, you know, because, like, if I could go in and say, I mean, that creates incentive systems for researchers to make their experiments fun, right? Right now there's no incentive to make it fun.
Well, I think that's exactly right. And this is one of the things we're wrestling with, A, because, you know, as academics, we don't necessarily know a lot about fun. And B, in terms of governing volunteer science, one of the things we actually have to care about is how enjoyable these experiments are, because if they're deadly boring, if you're paying students in the basement, that's fine. And on the other hand, if you're trying to get people to come back, that's not fine. And that both means that we need some type of consistency to the user experience. And the second is we need some degree of fun salted in. And so this is one of the things that we actually have to work with the people designing this, designing their experiments, is that they need to add that intangible element. And I'm not, you know, that, and that's going to be a, I think that's spot on, but it's also a bit of a challenge in terms of how to make
that happen. So just looking at the time, we have time for one more question and maybe another one if someone's going to explode.
Sure. So. I just have a comment. So yes, it would be great if we could gamify these experiments. But if you can successfully, consistently gamify an experiment, you should quit being an academic and start a game company. It's very, very difficult to create a game that actually gets people to stay. I mean, you know, you go to game conferences like GDC, the Game Developers Conference, and hundreds of people try this and they fail utterly, and it's only the few that make it. So, you know, if there was a way to study how to make something fun, that itself would be a huge research contribution.
There's a large body of literature on this. The fact is that people don't look at the literature. So there's I forget his name, is a scholar at Cornell that is actually doing games to do volunteer science, like in terms of detecting moths and so forth. So there's there's a big literature about games and what makes games fun, engaging, and so on. It's actually the challenges for us in our boring hats to be able to sort of see the thing. I think the most successful part has been what Folded did for protein engineering. And Folded basically transformed the problem space from one of maximizing energy levels and so forth into a game, and then they were able to beat the best scientists by having citizens engage.
Okay. Okay, it's a quick one.
Sure. First of all, my question's for Karim about the top coder contest. First of all, I've done a few of those NASA ones. I apologize for my poor performance.
I was the one.
And the second point, did the groups agree how they would split the prize?
Yeah, so we have data on, you know, they would allocate points to each other, and we take the average of that. So we have that as well. Yeah.
And so they negotiated that part. It wasn't just a 50-50 split.
No, it wasn't. We asked them, we allowed them to set it up. And the typical split was 70-30, 60-40,
70-30. Good. Okay, folks, we're going to have to go next door, across the street, so out through the parking lot, follow the Pied Piper. And it's right there. It's the Tang. No.
Wang Auditorium is Tang Building.
Yeah, so it'll say Tang Building on the outside. Sort of a 1960s, 70s structure.